0.1 in that lap, a tenth or so quicker than Lucas Lua managed in his first stint and the last lap around with a 45.2. So Tashkraft absolutely flying. Yeah. The car ahead of him, that is the battle for the overall race lead coming into West Bend.
And notice how the guys on the pit wall, they've just said Scott Tucker is in the car, so he knows it's the amateur driver, so he knows to not to expect it to be overly aggressive. And it, maybe he won't be holding exactly the same racing lines as the pro again. And plenty of room. This is very clever stuff from the pit wall. It shows again, we talked about teamwork, we talked about the human aspect, not just the track, not just the bullring that is Lime Rock here in Connecticut. These guys are working together, Jeremy, as a team, not just when they're changing tyres, when they come up against a situation like that, it's crucial for the driver to have all the relevant information.
Indeed, and he will have been told also that there is no need for that splash and go pit stop that they were thinking he was going to have to make when he came in just before this caution period started. So it's certainly played out in that car's favour, and Klaus Graf is now taking full advantage of it.
I hope they've got their numbers right. We've seen people forget to carry the one here and run out with in sight of the checkered flag. It has been that close. Now, this is not, remember, a lapped race. So 30 laps is the estimation by the guys on the pit wall. Running at 46 seconds or so a lap, there's 23 minutes left to go in this. It's 2 hours and 45 minutes, time certain, this American Le Mans Series fourth round, the Northeast Grand Prix here at Lime Rock Park.
Yeah, so this car leads the car number six, Klaus Graf, at the wheel of the Muscle Milk HPD Honda. Behind him in second place, Guy Smith, the gap back to the Lola Masters, about 3.4 seconds. Scott Tucker is hanging in there in third place overall, the best of the P2 cars.
But Martin Plowman's coming.
Yeah, that's what I was like. Give me time. Martin Plowman is about 10 seconds behind Scott Tucker. Last lap, he was a second faster.
Well, even by my rudimentary arithmetic, I'm not even going to call that mathematics, that would be 10 laps. He's even there or thereabouts.
But look at this. That was Scott Tucker going the inside. I guess that must have been the number 20 car they went down the inside of, because it's certainly one of the Dyson Lola Mazdas. And when they came across the line, that's Guy Smith ahead of us right now. So it was the other Lola Mazda that he went past. But Scott Tucker...
Slow lap by Guy last time around.
It was. But Scott's done a really good job this weekend. He's generally not been on anywhere close, really, let's face it, to the pace of Christoph Busch, who has a massive amount more experience. He's been in this racing car for best part of 30 years. Scott Tucker's only been doing it for about 5 or 6. But this weekend, he was within a half a second in qualifying. Scott Tucker drove the number 95 car for level 5 in qualifying, and only half a second down on Christoph Busch. Yes, it's a short lap, but still, that was not much of a deficit at all. He's doing a very good job this weekend. I would hazard a guess to say that this might be the best showing that Scott Tucker's actually put on since he moved up into the prototypes.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. And he's going to have to work a little bit harder, because it's down to 8 seconds now between himself and Martin Plowman, although Martin got the traffic last time. It's what goes around comes around, isn't it? It's easy to think, oh, he's lost 2 or 3 seconds. But that's traffic. And, you know, a lap or two later, the guy who's chasing has to do that as well.
Swings and roundabouts, ebbs and flows. That's what it's all about here at Lime Rock Park.
So on board there with Scott Tucker, with a clear track ahead of him. Great battle going on, by the way, in GT, where Jörg Bergmeister is leading Jan Magnussen by just over a second. And he's got his teammate Ollie Gavin 7/10 further back. So that's Porsche, Corvette. Guy Cosmo is the best of the Ferraris, and that's a good drive. Scott Sharp, by the way, still in fifth position, despite losing all that time in that yellow flag period, and he's still on the lead lap of GT. There's a story, as I said, a story not to be written off there. The two Crown Plaza BMWs, 56 and 55. Remember the 56 car with no bonnet, that's the easy one, no hood, the easy one to spot. That's got Dirk Müller at the wheel, Jörg is at the wheel of 55. They're in 6th and 7th, and they're salvaging points here for the rest of the season, Jeremy. Have no doubt about that. And this is the attitude you've got to have, whether it's a 12 or 24-hour race or just a 2-hour, 45-minute race. You can't give up just because things have gone rotten for you in the first half an hour.
Yeah, very much so. That is very much the case. As we see Klaus Graf one more time, 149th lap it is right now for our race leader. He's pulled out a whole 11 seconds over Guy Smith. So it looks like Smithy isn't able to get that car back out on terms. Meanwhile, in PC, there is a number five car. Colin Brown leads that class, but Tom Kimber-Smith, his teammate for Court Autosport, is only about 5 seconds behind him.
Townsend Bell at the wheel.
Again, there's Martin Plowman again, unlucky with the traffic coming through the chicane. Sorry, John.
And it was Townsend Bell that he was going by. And there he is going through that 23 Lotus, the battery tender Alex Job racing car, in a creditable 11th in GT. And they've had a couple of breaks this weekend, bit of weight taken out of that car. Still under development, that Lotus Evora. And under a slight disadvantage from some of the other teams, that they only have one car in the race, and it is only that car. Now, here is the GT lead battle. We're looking at it from Ollie Gavin, who is in third. Yeah. And in second is the car ahead, and in first is the car ahead. And there goes the leader. Wow, that's multi-class racing. It looked like we were chained to a post there. And trust me, Ollie Gavin had his big right foot pressed as hard down to the firewall with the throttle pedal underneath it as he possibly could. And yet we were passed like we were standing still. Three cars battling for the lead in GT.
And we're witnessing two of the best in the business do battle in GT, both Jan Magnussen and Jorg Burmeister, celebrating their 100th career start here in the American Le Mans Series. Jorg Burmeister and that Flying Lizards for Porsche has 5 championships on his resume, 34 wins, 64 podiums. You look at Jan Magnussen, he has 26 wins in ALMS, 64 podiums as well. He also has a championship. He won GT1 back in 2008. And another feather in Jan Magnussen's cap, he was voted most popular driver in 2011.
I think he's had that a couple of times, to be honest, Kelly, as well. First, second, third, and add Guy Cosmo in the ESM Ferrari to that, because just behind Ollie Gavin is the Viper green and black Extreme Speed Motorsports Ferrari 458. I tell you, there it is. It's four cars, 16 wheels, battling it out for the lead in GT. The street car class giving us great entertainment again. And not that I'm allowed to bet the house, but if I was, my darling wife wouldn't allow me to bet the house on this, because there's no way of telling any one of these four, or indeed none of them, could be standing on the top step of the podium in, what, 17 minutes time.
What a tremendous job by the 0-2 team. We saw Guy Cosmo took advantage of the strategy early on to lead very strongly indeed. Ed Brown did a nice job in the middle of the race, and he's handed that car back now to Guy Cosmo to finish off. And Guy Cosmo, as we heard about him talk about this track at the top of the show, born and bred on Long Island, this is his home racetrack.
Well, with Jeremy and I are going to take our very last breath before we come back to go to the checkered flag. There's your leaders here at Live Rock Park. Well, Jeremy Shaw and myself, John Hindorf, now clean and green to the checkered flag. We'll take you all the way through. Next up on the American Le Mans Series, round five, is the Mobil 1 Grand Prix at the Canadian Tire Motorsport Park. And there's the details flashing through the bottom of the screen as to when we will be live on the air. Always a great trip north of the border. Whilst we were away, nothing has happened. Well, actually, that's not true. These guys have been at it hammer and tongs. It's just there's been no place changes.
Yeah.
These guys are tied together with invisible but very short pieces of bungee rope at the moment.
And it's what's incredible is we've got a fabulous battle going also in GTC, where Lee Keane leads in the number 22 car by 0.4 of a second, as it came across last time, from Damien Faulkner in the Green Hornet car number 34. Also in PC, Colin Brown in the 05 car for Court Autosports leads by about a second over the 06 car, the teammate Tom Kimber-Smith. Absolutely unbelievable action going on here.
Five classes of car. That was GT, the top four together. This
plus
is P2.
P2, exactly.
This is battling for third and fourth overall, but for the win in class. And Martin Plowman has done a sterling job. You saw Scott Tucker there in the black car, the 055 leading, glancing in the right-hand mirror. He knows he's got company now.
Yeah, and Martin Plowman, he's been super patient. I'm very impressed with what he's done over the last 10 or 15 laps, because they've kind of been trading lap times. Scott Tucker's been doing an excellent job, given his the fact that he is an amateur driver. But Martin Plowman, I think, has the faster car. But yeah, absolutely, first time at track here for Martin Plowman. Never seen the place before. And they had the problems yesterday with a down-on-power engine. But he and David Heinemeier Hansson, they love the way the car is handling. But to come on this strong now is a very impressive run by Martin Plowman.
This is danger.
I'm just so impressed by the fact that he's a single-seater racer who's coming in and he's showing that patience is the key.
This is dangerous because they're going through the GT battle.
Things going to plan right now for the 37, but it has not been a trouble-free weekend by any means. In practice one, they rolled off the truck. Everything was good. By the end of the day yesterday, though, the team had to do an engine change. The crew was here until 1 o'clock in the morning. To be able to come out on the podium, let alone the top step of the podium, that would be huge for this team to be able to collect their first American Le Mans Series win. They have been working tirelessly in the offseason, testing and developing and really coming to grips with this. It's their first year of endurance racing, so they're learning this as they go through it, and right now the team is doing a terrific job.
Now, there's a spinner. It's the JDX11. That's the GTC car.
Third place.
That was third place in class. And that, well, I'm hearing it was the 33, but I'm not sure about that. I thought it was the 11. My apologies. We'll get that confirmed for you, but it was certainly one of the GTC cars. Meantime, Martin Plowman, as Jeremy says, just gets back onto the rear wing of Scott Tucker.
The class champion in P2 last year.
That's a good point.
Yeah, a lot of driving he's done over the last few seasons, but now Martin Plowman has got it. They've got themselves past all those GT cars and the GTC car there of Alex Welsh, who has now taken over third place from Chris Cumming.
It was
the 11 car that was off there. So Alex Welsh now driving with James Sofronis for the GMG team. Ooh, yikes.
That's more
dust. Third place.
That's the 66 car that's gone off in the same spot as the 11 did one lap before. And there's words that you don't normally have. Spencer Pumpelly off. Write that down in your diary, because that's very unusual. This team, the guys with the Morgan, the Conquest guys, they've done a cracking job. Remember at Sebring, they had a completely different engine package, and they decided in the relatively short time between the end of Sebring, a 12-hour race, and going onto the main streets of Long Beach to change engine supplier, and they went to Nissan, proven engine supplier. But that's not the work of a moment, is it? You don't just bolt one out and bolt one in. And they've got the grips with that. They've been very strong since putting that Nissan engine in, and this could be their best result to date.
Yeah, hats off to Scott Tucker again.
He's doing a great job.
7 he did that last lap. He's turning some very good lap times now. He's really got his head down. He's got David Stone on the radio, and also Jeff Brown, who is the chief engineer at Level 5 Motorsports. And he's a very good, experienced, calm hand and voice on the radio. And he's coaching Scott Tucker extremely well.
9 minutes to go.
You can hear that's how long Scott Tucker has to hold on for. The gap between these two was...
Over him, you know, I mean, he's a gentleman, you need to do it, okay?
Off has gone the 0-2 car. Oh no, that's Guy Cosmo out of fourth place, and that is severe damage on the back of that car. He's gone off, I think that's at the first turn.
No, I think it's at the downhill, is it? The diamond turn.
Oh, you're right, and it's a full course caution. Well, this could be all she wrote with only 8.5 minutes to go. Well, that's a disaster for ESM. Battling for a podium. There are the guys in the pit lane, and look at the body language there. There's a sense of resignation. What an up and down day they've had. What's bad news for him is good news. You're right, it was the diving turn. Jeremy, good spot. What's bad news for them is better news for Scott Sharp, who takes over position in the team car. Well, that's both ends of that car. That's an odd one.
Well, I think he's probably gone around and sort of spun around in the barriers down there.
Yeah, might be right.
Because that's a very fun... You're going very, very quickly.
The left hand is moving. Guy Cosmo's left hand is moving. I think he's trying to get the guys to pull the car out. I'm not sure he realises how bad that is. The thumbs have gone up there. So the safety crew... And by the way, a word for all of the corner marshals, corner workers, marshals and safety crew, not just here, but all the way around... And those guys do the hardest job in motorsport, often for very little reward, giving up their spare time We haven't got enough marshals and corner workers in motorsport anywhere in the world. If you're a true enthusiast and you've got some time, you could do a lot worse than giving up some of it to make sure that our racing can continue. Now, word on the radio from Guy Cosmo that there was a PC car involved in this. We'll get a chance to have a look at Guy. Knows this track very well. Yeah. Did our Patron track description at the start of the show. So, Jeremy, watching the background of the shot. Well, he's already off there. And as you rightly see, he's gone in backwards. Who is that? Is that the Dempsey Racing car?
No.
I think it's one of the coolers.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, dear.
Oh, dear. That was not smart. Now, which challenge car is it? It is.
It's one of the core order sport cars. Tough to see which one it was from that angle, to be honest.
It might have been the 06 car.
I think it was.
I think it's the 06 car. Yeah. I'm speculating on that. We'll wait for a confirmation. Well, I'm very disappointed for Guy, for Scott, and the rest of the ESM Ferrari team. I'm more disappointed that we've been robbed of a race to the flag in P2, in GT, in GTC, where Damien Faulkner had got right up behind Lee Keane. And, of course, any problems that Klaus Graf might have had, might, in terms of fuel mileage, is gone completely now. And that was the other thing that was just at the back of my mind. The crowd have had a great weekend and have come in big numbers, as ever, to Lime Rock Park, and our thanks to them and indeed everyone here at the track for making our job much easier. It is a super place to come and work, I have to say. Guy is not a happy bunny.
No,
we couldn't broadcast the radio communications.
Yeah, I'll bet. He was doing what he had to do down there. That's not a place where you can let somebody pass
easily,
no. And GT cars are very quick through that diving turn, the downhill there here at Lime Rock Park, onto the fastest part of the course, and that's not the place where you make a dive bomb move at the last minute, which is what it looked like the Core Sport car did. And I think it was, well, whichever one it was, it's not a pass that's really on, particularly at this stage in the race. Yeah, there's still a battle on between the two Core Sport cars, so the 06 are trying to track down the 05. There wasn't much between those two cars. But that was a very unfortunate incident, and we've still got 4 minutes to go. Whether they'll be able to get that car out of the way in enough time to go green, I doubt it.
Where that car is, there's nowhere to pull it to a place of safety, I don't think.
Well, across the road.
Well, yes. So 4 minutes and 11. 4 minutes and 7 seconds now. Klaus Graf leads by over 10 seconds underneath the safety car procedures. So the Panamera going around. So the car leading the race, of course, didn't have the best of starts. Klaus Graf with a gearbox problem had to go to control alt delete and then was sent back into the race with this instruction. And my goodness me, did he get out of there?
He did get out of there, but he got out of there a bit too hot, actually. I think it was actually coming in that they had a speeding penalty right after that. They had to serve that stop and go penalty as well, but they come all the way back from that. A magnificent first stint by Lucas Lure, and then the great work carried on magnificently by Klaus Graf, who has set the fastest lap of the race, a new track record here at Lime Rock Park, of 45.148 seconds, so well over a second quicker than the track record.
And for that, they are the recipients of the Battery Tender Hard Charger Award for the fourth round of the American Le Mans Series, presented by Tequila Patron. So, Jeremy, we never like to see racers finishing under full course caution. It appears that that is what is going to happen. Let's have some thoughts about what we've seen. Five classes, we've talked about that a lot, and three of them still absolutely nose and tail as we came under this fifth full course caution.
Yeah, it's been a tremendous motor race, I think, from top to bottom in the field. Various people have had problems. One guy we haven't talked about, perhaps, is Bruno Junqueira for RSR Racing in PC. That car's been fast, but they had a long pit stop early on. We've seen several people have longer delays and come back and get back themselves into contention. Not the case for that car, but, you know, there's been some fabulous battles, and I think it's just, I think it's been tremendously entertaining.
Return to form for the Flying Lizards after their nightmare start to the season and an even worse trip out to France for Le Mans. Thomas Blom on the wall, Seth Nyman and the rest of the guys. The 45 car going well. The 44 car it is this weekend. Who's had all the problems?
Yeah, after qualifying extremely well. So I think they showed the speed of the Lizard Porsches. But they've had, as we've talked about earlier on, and the drivers have talked about, they had a very difficult start to the season. But they felt they turned the corner at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca last time out. And certainly this weekend, they've come on stronger and stronger as the weekend has gone along, and they've been very fast in the race. Patrick Long got that car out in the lead early on, and Jörg Bergmeister has held on in the face of some absolutely superb competition.
And fuel mileage, the key. They stayed out long. They didn't take the opportunity to pit when they needed to, and they got great mileage out of that car, and that helped them with their tactics. As you heard, the white flag is going out. One lap. A quick mention for Lee Keane and Alex Job Racing in the 22 WeatherTech car. Started on pole position, and it's not very often that the GTC has won from pole. Damien Faulkner, at one stage, at least a couple of laps down when he took over that 34, the 34 Green Hornet car in second place. And what a weekend as well for the GMG car in third position. Alex Welsh back in that car at the end. But the day surely belongs not only in terms of the battery tender hard charger award, but at the front of the field to Greg Pickett and Muscle Milk Racing. Kelly?
Standing by with a team owner here for Muscle Milk Pickett Racing, Greg Pickett. Amazing race. I can't believe you finished here. I'm sure you can't. What were you thinking as that race unfolded?
No, you can't believe it. It's not over until it's over. The guys were magnificent today. And we hang in there at Muscle Milk. It's not often that I'm speechless, as you probably know, but I'm so proud of the guys. Lucas's stint was unbelievable. Klausy is just a real fighter out there. I've got two fabulous world-class guys in the car. On behalf of Muscle Milk, HPD, Nikki Worth over in England, and everybody, I just couldn't be happy. I'm happy that Guy Cosmo's okay, frankly. And what can I say about my friends, the Dysons? They fought us like crazy, so.
He's coming to the checkered flag here, Greg.
It's unbelievable. I just could not.
Nine. Do you know, emotion in sport is entirely appropriate at times like this. And I'm glad he mentioned the tall man with the brain the size of Planet back in the UK, Nick Worth, who's been so instrumental in this HPD line of ERX cars. And there'll be a lot of people at Worth Research who are loving the fact that the Stars and Stripes liveried car on the weekend after Independence Day has managed to take the victory. We'll claim a little bit back for the Empire, given that it was designed in the UK. But this weekend belongs to Klaus Graf and the rest of the guys from Musselbill. Back with more reaction next. Oh, I think the expression now is and breathe, isn't it? John Heinhoff and Jeremy Shaw just getting our breath back after an extraordinary 2 hours and 45 minutes for the fourth round of the American Le Mans Series, the Northeast Grand Prix here at Lime Rock Park, Connecticut. And unfortunately, ending up under a yellow flag. But notwithstanding that, it has been a great race with at least three of the five classes in dispute until, well, that full course caution. Dyson Racing with the Mazda Power prototypes in second, but it's Muscle Milk at the top of P1.
And what can you say about this Muscle Milk Honda team and Klaus Graf coming back four laps down? You take the overall win. We just saw your team owner, Greg Pickett, get a little bit choked up talking about today. What was this race like for you?
Oh, very emotional. I mean, what a comeback. We had to push so hard, and great job by Lucas and the team. The crew did an awesome job on the strategy to gain the laps back, and I had to push like crazy, qualified every lap, and our Mazda Milk Honda car did extremely well. I'm very proud of everybody. Thanks to Michelin for awesome tires.
Talk about making that last pass there to getting the overall.
Well, I knew he was a little quick on the straight, and I knew that's my only shot, really, and passing him on the outside is sketchy, obviously, but really respect the way Guy Smith was racing, so that was very fair, and I appreciate that, so thanks for that.
Three in a row for Muscle Milk Honda. Congratulations.
GT, no less of a battle, of course, with four cars, including the unfortunate Guy Cosmo at the end, battling for three podium positions in the end. The 0-1 benefited from the problem of its teammates. Two Corvettes, second and third. But a return to the top step for Flying Lizard Motorsport for the first time this season, indeed the first time since Petit Le Mans at the end of last year.
Flying Lizard Motorsports has had a dry spell unlike any other. You guys haven't had a win all year. Porsche hasn't had a win all year. Jörg, what does this mean to the team when it's an event where you cannot make a mistake?
Well, it was a long coming. We had a lot of problems all year long, a lot of bad luck especially. Actually, even at the last race, we had a good car, a little mishap down the pit stop and dropped back with a stop-and-go penalty. But this one was just flawless, like the last couple of years here. For me, I don't know. I can't do anything wrong here, I guess. It's my, I think, sixth win here in 7 years, so I like this place.
Sixth win in 7 years is a fantastic record, yet you still booked a flight home for tonight. You got out of the car and said you're not going to make that flight back to Germany. What will the celebration be like for the team?
Well, we're just planning on it. We're probably driving to Manhattan tonight and partying a bit there.
Sounds like it'll be a fun time. Congratulations.
Well earned, I reckon.
Yeah, I think I may have to keep an eye on my rear view mirror. Another battle that went all the way to the end, and really there's three or four cars in that graphic that could have been the winner. Well done to Ricardo Nende to come back. Good result for Tom Kimber-Smith, confirmed for the whole season for Core, but it's the 0-5 car that takes the victory.
Well, it was a 1-2 finish for Core Autosport in the PC class, and it's two in a row now for Colin Braun and John Bennett. And Colin, car doesn't look entirely clean. How'd you manage to bring this home to victory lane?
It was a great race. John did such a good job early on in that race, kept the car clean, turned it over to me. My guys had a really good stop and made a good strategy call to take some tires, I think, there at the end, and restarted third and was able to get to the lead in the first lap, so just had to push really hard and then just kind of manage the gap from behind from then on. So just hats off to the guys. They're doing a great job this season, and pleasure to drive for this team, and John and Morgan's a lot of fun. I'm having a lot of fun this year.
Corrado Sport certainly on a roll. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Well, that's three of the five categories put to bed. Still a couple to come, and both of them were by no means sorted either. In fact, there might have been a slight sigh of relief from Scott Tucker in P2, and certainly one from Lee Keane, as Damien Faulkner was hoving into view behind him with that full course caution with just a few minutes to go, 6 minutes or thereabouts to go. Certainly the crowd have had their money's worth this weekend. Here is the results of the second prototype category. Patrick Dempsey with Joey Foster on the podium for the first time for Dempsey Racing. Conquest in second place for the 37 car. And Level 5 Motorsports gambled on one car, and the gamble paid off.
Level 5 Motorsports remains undefeated for the season. It is the third win of the year for the car. Number 055 of Scott Tucker and Christoph Buschu. But Scott Tucker, you were working there at the end. That was some tough fight before the yellow flag came out. How exhausted are you?
That was a tough one. The Conquest team is really good, and it could have went either way. But fortunately, we came out on top today, and I'm sure we'll see him again. But it's a good day for the team. Gave me a great car. We gambled on a few things, and it paid off.
And certainly is a great battle that's heating up as we head into these summer races. But for you and Christoph, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
So the final set of results is that of GTC. GMG Racing, the 32 car, on the podium. Green Hornet Racing, Damien Faulkner coming back from at least a couple down to second place. But the pole sitters, Alex Job Racing in the WeatherTech Porsche, win it.
Cooper McNeil led the points, but he told me it was really important to get a win. So for you, Lee Keane, his teammate today, what does it mean to get this victory?
Well, it means a lot. I mean, the guys have been working so hard all year, and all the Alex Job guys really deserve this win. So it was great to have the WeatherTech car up on pole. And Cooper did an awesome job at his stint. And it was pretty wild out there. I had to go off track twice, just missing cars and in total chaos. But in the end, we brought it home in first place, so it feels great.
All right, congratulations.
Well, Jeremy, I have no idea what to say after all of that. We've got one more result to show you. That is the Green X Challenge 1. Some sucker for Sky, for Dyson Racing with the Mazda-powered prototype running on isobutanol. It's such an efficient fuel. An easy victory there, not translated to a win on the track from Muscle Milk and Conquest Endurance. We've barely got a couple of weeks to settle ourselves down before we are racing again. And the Flying Lizard Motorsports take the GT version of Michelin Green X Challenge ahead of BMW. Look how much closer that is, because those guys are all running on E85 fuel, all of course got the same calorific value, the same efficiency value from the 02 of Extreme Speed Motorsport. Just a couple of weeks, Jeremy, for us to give ourselves a rub down with some halibut oil and get ourselves ready for the trip up north to Canadian Tires Motorsport Park, the Mobil 1 Grand Prix. What do you say other than wow?
Yeah, exactly. It's going to be another fantastic race in a couple of weeks' time. This was a great one. I have to say, must say, my hat's off to Scott Tucker. I think he really came of age this afternoon. He's been getting better and better of a driver. Massive amount of driving time he's having over the last couple of years. But today was a really good performance by him. He had a lot of pressure in the final 10 laps of the race from Martin Plowman. You look at the fastest laps between those two leaders in P2, nothing between them.
For Jeremy Shaw and the rest of the team, I'm John Hindhoff. Bye for now.